I'm Carly Caricelli from PNC. At PNC, we strive for a culture where our people are encouraged to bring their whole selves to work and to share their diverse ideas and backgrounds. Thank you for attending today's forum to learn more about how to prioritize diversity, equity, and inclusion too. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Dorothy Grill, who is the Workforce Initiative Coordinator for the Agency for Community Empowerment of NEPA and an adjunct instructor at Lackawanna College. She's a three-time graduate of Marywood University, most recently earning her PhD in 2019. She has experience speaking about leadership, career services, and diversity. She's a member of the Junior College of Scranton and the Scranton Rotary. Now, let's welcome Dorothy Grill.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Dorothy Grill, and I am the Workforce Coordinator at Agency for Community Empowerment of Northeastern Pennsylvania. I'm also an adjunct instructor at Lackawanna College. I'm here today to talk to you about making your team culturally diverse and inclusive and how you lead by example. So when we talk about diversity as a team, a lot of people get hung up on looking at either the race or maybe the gender or maybe even, you know, disability. But diversity, especially when you're talking about diversifying your teams at work or in community service that you do, is much more than that. So we can be talking about diversifying them from the age of the individual, also from the culture or the background experiences that they've had, and also the socioeconomic status of the individual. So what that, you know, diversity is much more than just checkmarking a box with, like I said, race or gender or disability or even age for that matter. It's getting all those voices heard, especially as a leader, that should be your primary focus. So when we talk about cultures, there's three levels of cultures that are in an organization. The first level is artifacts. So that's when you walk into an organization, what you see, the signs you see, what you see as the layout of the office, the logos, the clothing of the individuals working in that office. It's what you can see as an outsider. Then we go into espoused values, which are the values and rules of conduct that are adopted over time from every leader that comes into the organization. So each time there's a change of leadership at an organization, you are going to have a change in what the values are and what the focus is, and maybe even sometimes the rules of conduct as well. So these are the things that the employees know to be true and what is accepted as the rules of the organization. The third level, the assumptions, are what are deeply embedded in an organization and might even be unconscious to those that work there. So they are very hard even from within the organization to recognize, because it's those things where if you question it as a newcomer, you are told that it has always been that way and always will be that way. So no one can actually, at this level of culture, say where this idea or rule or way of doing things, policy, procedure, actually came about. It's just what is accepted as the end-all, be-all of that organization. So when we talk about company culture, there's a lot that goes into it. So if you imagine it as an iceberg, you're going to have what is visible to the naked eye, what's seen above water. So that's going to be things like your individuals that work there, your location, maybe the benefits, the dress code, and the office environment. But then we get into much more deeper than that. So we talk about, especially with diversity, equity, inclusion, having trust to have that different voice, having the core values of respecting each other. Also, what the narrative is of that organization. So is it an organization that is welcoming and wants to hear the different voices of individuals? And as a leader, are you making sure that's happening at least in the section of the organization that you may be leading? Also, the openness to have the hard discussions. So when something does happen, do you have the right channels in place as a leader to have those open discussions and be able to be flexible and understand where other people might be coming from? And then finally, the purpose and expectations. So as a leader, you're going to have a purpose. You're going to have expectations of your team. And you might even have a vision for where your team is going. How does all three of those get affected by the individuals and the diversity that they bring to the team with the idea of working with your idea of what you see to be accurate and their reality of what they see to be accurate? And how do you meet somewhere in the middle as a compromise? One of the things that you want to be careful of avoiding is a blame culture. You don't want to set it up as a leader where people feel that they're frequently singled out or blamed or criticized for mistakes, errors, or the way that they view things because of their diversity. This is going to tend to result in a situation where people are reluctant to accept responsibility for their actions, and also an environment where people are going to be quiet and afraid to say anything for fear of criticism and reprimands from their leaders. It also results in people who are unwilling to take risks or speak out and have that employee voice that's so important with diversity, equity, and inclusion. So with that, you're going to see turnover. You're going to see people afraid to talk. And ultimately, your culture in the organization is going to become one where it is really they just sit there and take that day-to-day. Everything goes down to that third level of culture with the assumptions. And no one wants to take a risk of changing what the agency or the organization does. So in order to stop that and make sure that doesn't happen, you want to make sure you're setting the bar as the leader, that the culture is a welcoming, inclusive culture that makes sure that everyone's voice is heard. Everyone has that ability to express their concerns, their needs, and their ideas for the organization. With myself, as I shared, I'm a coordinator of an office of 7 individuals who are all unique in their own way. So with that, I have to set the bar and sometimes have to become the mediator between personality conflicts that are going to happen as a result of the diversity in the way people view what is going on and what was said and what was done. So as a leader, what I do is I set up from day one when I start a new employee at an organization that I have an open door policy. If they need to come talk to me in confidence, it's not that I'm going to go to the person they're having the problem with and tell them, you know, Joe came to me and complained that you said something to him that upset him. I am going to address it, but in a more calmer manner and in a manner that protects that employee that is having the trouble with what is being said or done in the office. In addition, you also have to see it from the other side of the viewpoint as well of the individual that said it. So is there a different way that you can even sit maybe the two employees down and figure out how they could work together collaboratively instead of against each other? So as a leader, you want to immediately cut out blaming yourself and others. You want to define the why you are doing something as much as the what you are doing. So people understand, especially when it's going against their own values or their own diversity, why you have to do it the way you're doing it. You want to have follow-up with your employees or your individuals that you're leading. So easy way to do this is to do check-ins with them. You know, how is everything going? What could I do different to make you happier here? What might we be able to make changes? And finally, when you're in a leadership role, it's all about also looking at yourself and what you're doing. Are you always following the idea of having that welcoming and inclusive environment? You have to be very careful as a leader not to have favorite employees, that they always get their way and everyone else is kind of shut out. And then finally, you know, there's many benefits to having this culturally diverse workplace or having cultural diversity in the workplace. So when you look at diversity in the workplace, it's been proven that this helps develop and maximize skill set. It also is going to improve your recruitment process because people are going to be excited about working there, which in turn is going to show when you're bringing that prospective individual through for an interview, they're going to be able to read other people's body language in that office. It also can help you retain talent. So by giving your employees a voice and letting them experience what it is that they need to experience, this can help you retain them because they're going to feel valued and a part of that team. It also can improve team's creativity. So anytime you're in a leadership role, your hiring management team is going to be looking at you to solve the problems that your area is facing. Yes, you might be able to solve it as yourself, but it might not be the best or most innovative way to solve that problem. So by giving your team a voice in that, especially when it's a major decision, like here's a major problem, how are we going to solve that? That allows them to give you their opinions, their thoughts on it, and gives you much more options to evaluate to see which is the best fit for the organization. It also can help with employee engagement. So as a leader, you never want to walk into your office and have the situation happen where individuals see you coming and they're like, oh no, here comes the boss. Got to pretend I'm busy. Don't want to make any kind of eye contact. I don't want to engage with that individual. They're upper management. I'm scared to death of them even looking at me because they might critique me. What you want to do is have that cultural diversity where they're excited to see you. Maybe they've been thinking about a problem that you don't even know exists yet. So they're not only going to make you aware of that problem, but they're going to be empowered to have solutions to that problem. Maybe they've already sat down with a few of their teammates to start to talk about the problem. And finally, cultural diversity will improve your company's reputation. So, of course, naturally, when you're dealing with social media, the quickness of way stuff goes out anymore, you want to make sure that reputation of your company or organization is protected. So by stepping up and making sure you have a cultural diverse environment for your employees, this is going to help you define that reputation as a workplace that is open, that is excited to work with employees to develop ideas and solutions to problems. And it's going to set you up as being one of the change makers in the space that you're trying to operate in. Because after all, you are the one that's stepping up and saying, this is important to us as an organization. Or even if it's a smaller part of the organization, if you're on my team at work, this is an important piece to it. Because as leaders, remember, it's not always that you're going to always stay at the same organization for the next 50 years. So you want to empower those on your team that might be future leaders in training to start to develop those skill sets as well and see the importance of this cultural diversity in the workplace so that they can further develop the team and help you kind of coach them along. I saw this the other day at the office where I worked. I walked back in from a meeting and the team was sitting down at our conference table planning out solutions to a situation that had arose with the rideshare program that we have. right now, because of the size of our organization and everything that goes into it, we can only help individuals that are currently working. So they were planning a solution, and to the individuals that might come through on the phone who might not be aware of that piece of the application. So I didn't even know that was an issue that was going on until I walked into my staff sitting down going through that. But they already had several solutions to present to me, some of which I would never even have thought of myself. So again, going back to that creativity piece and empowering those on your staff to have a voice. Thank you so much for coming to my talk. And are there any questions?